Is it getting real?
Very close. Well, we're very, very close. We're very close to the delegates, and the thing that makes me most happy in the history of the Republican Party, nobody has ever gotten this many votes. So
you still have a lot of states to go.
And we have a lot to go. So it's been such an honor. It's been a lot of fun. It must be because I do your show.
I think it's a big part of it. That's what I
have a feeling.
I may agree with you on that part.
I have a feeling.
Today was a very big day. You have a list of names.
I do.
And you had talked to me for a while now about releasing these names. Your judicial philosophy. You said you wanted originalists. You said you wanted people like Antonin Scalia and Clarence Thomas on the Supreme Court.
It's true.
Tell us about this list of names.
Well, I've been having a lot of feedback from a lot of different people, and I've had, as you know, tremendous endorsements, and I'm a conservative, and I may have different views on different things, and I think I'm extremely conservative, as an example, on trade. But a conservative would say I'm not, because I don't necessarily believe only in free trade. You know what I believe on trade is good deals for the United States.
Fair trade.
Well, somebody said to me, what is your view on trade? I said, my view is good deals for the United States. It's a very simple view. And if you can call it conservative, call it whatever you want. But so with the judges, they were saying, well, what happens if he appoints the wrong judges? And what we did, and I just have it, we just took a list of judges.
And yeah.
I thought what I would do is put this forward, and this would be the list that I would either choose from or pick people very close in terms of the spirit and the meaning of what they represent. And of course, Justice Scalia is mentioned in here as right up front as being just one of our great judges and one of our great justices. And I came up with a list. The Federalist Society was very much involved. Various people were involved. As you know, Jeff Sessions is, to me, somebody that I have great respect
for. It's gotten very good reviews from its immediate release.
It's gotten great reviews. The people that have seen it have given it. So if you want, I will I will do it now. If you'd like me to read them,
I
can read them. I hope your people aren't going to fall asleep as I read them.
No, only take a second.
But these are highly respected conservative people. Again, Federalist Society and others with the input. Stephen Colaton of Iowa, a man who is really an amazing person. Allison Ide of Colorado. Raymond Gruender, and Raymond is from Missouri. Thomas Hardiman of Pennsylvania. Raymond Kethledge of Michigan. Joan Larson, also of Michigan, but I think I'm going to do very well, by the way, in the general election. I think we're going to do very well. Thomas Lee of Utah. William Pryor.
By the way, Thomas Lee of Utah is related to Mike Lee.
Brother. Right. And Mike Lee's a great guy, and his brother is highly respected. William H. Pryor of Alabama. David Strauss of somebody that... A friend of mine who's a great lawyer said this is a fantastic man. David Strauss of Minnesota, Diane Sykes of Wisconsin, Don Willette of Texas, and that's your list. And we're going to either choose from this list or people very close to it in terms of their...
So this is your judicial philosophy.
Yes,
that's right. You know, one of the things I think people would question, I had interviewed you a lot during this process, and you gave me very specific things. And one of the top things I would ask you often is your judicial philosophy. And you mentioned, as I said, Scalia and Thomas. They are what we call originalists,
right?
Constitutionalists.
Correct.
You are a constitutionalist.
Correct. And I'm also, I want high intellect. I want great intellect. These people are all of very high intellect. They're pro-life. And so that's my list. And we are going to choose from, most likely from this list, but... at a minimum, we will keep people within this general realm. And again, I have a lot of people that are conservative that really like me, love everything I stand for, but they really would like to know my view, because perhaps outside of the defense of our country, perhaps the single most important thing the next president is going to have to do is pick Supreme Court justices.
This will have an impact for generations to come.
Oh, generations. And I will say, if Hillary Clinton, who is doing very poorly in this whole rigged system that,
that
Sanders
that.
Happens to be in.
Yeah.
But if Hillary Clinton, for some reason, wins, your country will never be the same, because she's going to put disasters on the Supreme Court. So these are
This is interesting because I think there might have been some people. I've talked to people on the radio show, and some people said, well, Donald Trump's a recent convert to conservatism. And I asked you very specific questions. For example, you know, you say you want a balanced budget. You actually told me once it's immoral to steal from our kids.
Well, I do want a balanced budget. We could do it a lot quicker. I mean, I've heard people say we'll balance the budget within 20 years. I'm saying 20 years? What are you talking about? I do want a balanced budget. And you have to understand, I was born in New York, and I really started my business, you know, I was in Brooklyn and Queens with my father, but I moved to Manhattan, and I started doing very, very well in Manhattan. And if you look at the statistics on Manhattan, whether you, you know, like them or don't like them, it's very liberal, it's very Democrat, and I think that, you know, probably a lot of people feel because I come from essentially Manhattan, I would be that way. And I wanted to put this list out because I wanted to quell any fears that people may have. I mean, this is a list of people that I got them from people I most respect.
And you vetted each one. You almost did it like a job interview.
Well, I vetted, but to a much greater extent, the Federalist Society vetted and has tremendous respect. Heritage has looked at it, who I have great, great respect for. And I know Senator Sessions has brought the names around to different people in the Senate. And people have seen the list. I mean, people have seen the list, but you're the first one that's seen it publicly.
Yeah, you know, this is, I think, the most important thing is you now transition to a general election. You talked about very specific things. And I think when you look at all the exit polls and 65% of Republicans feel betrayed by the Republican Party that they haven't kept their promises.
I felt betrayed.
I felt betrayed too.
I'm doing this. I mean, yeah. I had a very nice life. I had a very simple life. I have this great company. I have a wonderful family. I complicated my life. That I can tell you, although I'm having a good time doing it. But
it's not
I'm
hurting
having
your bottom
a good
line.
Time.
I noticed your financial statement. You're still doing okay financially.
We're doing well. We put in our financials 2 days ago, and people are seeing you. I built a great company. That's why I'm saying people are saying, why are you doing this? You know, you're at a point where you can just take it nice and easy and go to Turnberry in Scotland and go to Doral and do all these things that you want to do. But I'm doing it because, you know, I'm putting back. I want to put back.
You want to give back.
I want to give back, put back. What I want to do is make America great again. You know, the theme is such a great theme. And I didn't even realize it was that good until I started really getting out there. And I add to it, and it's called America First. We're going to put America First on trade deals. It's like we make deals. They're so bad. They're so inconceivably bad. And I said, no, no. We want you all to do well, but it's America First. When China's ripping us to, you know, you look at trade deficits of $500 billion a year, who's negotiating
these
deals?
You want fair trade. You're not a protectionist. You want better deals.
I want fair trade. The problem with fair trade, the people we have now are incompetent. Our president is, you know, he used a word the other day, not a nice word, but he's an ignorant president. He's an ignorant president. He doesn't know what's going on, in my opinion, okay? And the opinion of plenty of other people.
Well, statistics also speak. Millions more in poverty, millions more in food stamps, median income down thousands of dollars. He has taken on more debt than every other president
before.
You're
right, but it's not only that.
By the way, one in five American families don't have a single member of the family working today.
Okay, and so much more. Look, so much more. And you say that, and I hear you say that, but so much more. We're losing our jobs. They're moving to Mexico. Listen, our jobs. You look at Kerry, you look at Ford, you look at all these companies, Nabisco. They're moving plants to Mexico. We're losing our jobs. We're losing our money. We're not making things. Pretty soon we're not going to make anything anymore. I just felt I had an obligation to do this. You look at our trade deals. I will make those deals so good, so fast. And you know what? We'll have great relationships with these countries. We don't have a good relationship with China. China's building a massive fortress in the middle of the South China Sea, okay? And yet they're ripping money from us left and right. We rebuilt China single-handedly. What they've taken out of our country, we have rebuilt China. They have railroads and trains that go 250 miles an hour. We have the Long Island Railroad that chugs out to Long Island. Chug.
I've been on it many times.
We don't have anything. We've become a third world country. I'll tell you
what.
And a lot of the technology is our technology. I mean, we're selling technology to the world and we don't have it ourselves because we've spent $4 trillion plus in the Middle East. We're in worse shape now than we were 15 years ago. 15 years ago, if we wouldn't have done anything, we would have been much better. You wouldn't have had the migration. You would have had a couple of dictators, killers, They call them strong men. They can call them whatever they want. And they were good at one thing, killing terrorists. And right now, you look at Iraq, that's like Harvard for terrorism.
I want to stay on this focus, though, because you made a promise to release the names so people would know your judicial philosophy.
That's right.
You're making a promise to balance the budget. You're making a promise to build the wall. You made a promise you're going to repeal Obamacare
100%.
And replace
it
with?
We have no choice.
Replace it
by
with?
By the way, you don't even have to repeal. We're going to do it before it happens.
It's falling
in 17, it's going to implode. And in fact, on November 1st, new numbers are coming out. Right before the election, they're trying to change the date. They want to make it after the election. And it's going to show the increase necessary to sustain Obamacare. And it's going to be massive. Everyone's talking about it.
Are these promises?
Don't let anybody change that date.
And you want to replace it with health savings accounts, maybe?
Yes, but there's so many other things. Just so you understand, once we get competition going with free enterprise, where the insurance companies actually have to go and compete instead of having states as a monopoly, you get rid of the borders, you get rid of the lines, right, where they can't go outside. Once we get rid of that, and they almost had it this time, they could have had it this time, and you would have seen such competition, there will be plans, healthcare plans, that you never even heard about, that haven't even been thought about right now. There will be such competition, it'll be a beautiful thing. The numbers will go way down. First of all, Obamacare is no good. The premiums are through the roof, but have you looked at deductibles lately?
It's huge.
Unless you're
5,000,
dead,
10,000.
Unless you're dead or in the process of almost death, you can't use them.
What I'm trying to get to is, with the release of this, these names, that was a big promise. Balancing a budget is a big promise. Building a wall is a big promise. Repealing Obamacare is a big promise. I understand you're giving a speech next week on energy independence.
Right.
That's a big promise.
In North Dakota.
Building our military, taking care of our vets, those are big promises. Ending Common Core. So my question is, on those agenda items that you have told me about in our interviews, how rock solid are those promises for the people that may be on the fence that want to know you're going to do those things?
I want to get it all done.
You want to get
Look,
it all done.
Our military, I saw a show the other day, perhaps not even on your on the Great Fox, but I saw a show the other day where our fighter planes are so old that they go to junkyards to get parts. They call them graveyard, airplane graveyards, to take parts off old planes that haven't been flown in 25 years. They're taking parts off these planes and trying to put them on and fix them on our fighter jets. We are really in trouble. Our military is so depleted.